A lot of places you could be this weekend, but you decided to hang out with us. I was driving to church this weekend, and I get an email from Jeff Jones, and it says, the subject line, Ryan Leek's best message ever. And I thought to myself, who's preaching this weekend? Because I didn't know it was going to be that. And then me and Jeff talked and said, hey, what's one of your favorite messages? That's one of your best messages that you've never given at Chase Oaks that you would love to. And I was like, oh, man, I've been working on this new book and I would love to share. And then they sent out that clickbait. You fell for it. Now you're here. So nevertheless, got a message for you today based off of a book of mine that I've written. It comes out in March, but you can pre-order it right now. It's called How to Work with Complicated People. Now, strategies for effective collaboration with nearly anyone. Emphasis on the word nearly because some people are certified crazy and can't work with everybody. Nevertheless, one of the things that the Lord called me to do a long time ago was to write books that Christians actually could share with their friends at work that aren't technically Christian books, but they are books that are birthed in Christian values and based off of things that I've learned in the Bible. And so you're actually going to, just so you know, this came in the mail this weekend. So you're the first people to ever even see this, okay? So this is real special. So I'm giving you a sneak peek into some of that content, except you get the real Bible biblical strategies that I've learned on how to work with complicated people. Now, here's what's interesting. We did a national research study across working America to figure out, man, how are people navigating the complexities of their workplace? And one of the questions we asked was, we said, hey, here's the deal. We're not gonna tell you our definition of complicated. We want you to tell us your definition of complicated, because what we have learned is that complicated is often in the eye of the beholder. In other words, there is somebody in your life that you have deemed complicated that I would think is very simple. And there's people in my life that I've deemed complicated that you would go, they're easy to get along with. And so it can be somewhat objective, right? And so we said, hey, why don't you give us your definition of complicated? Here's what one person wrote, guy named Nate. I said, listen, I don't think you understand the question, okay? Another person wrote, this lady I work with named Leslie. I said, hold on now, what did Nate and Leslie do? And then another person wrote, cantankerous. I didn't even know that was a word. I learned it in the study. Machiavellian, numbskull. Another person just wrote, they're really dumb. I'm like, people are really going through it. Now, here's what I realized about you and me is perhaps we work, live with, married a Leslie or a Nate. By the way, if your name is actually Leslie or Nate, I ain't got nothing against you. But somebody does. Okay, I don't know who it is, but somebody does. But the reality is most people's go-to strategy when it comes to complicated people in their life is to simply steer away from them. They just try and ignore them. But here's what we learned in our research. Complicated people are unavoidable, okay? Because some people think, oh, I'm just gonna quit this job and get rid of these people, and then they go to a new job, and guess what they find there? More complicated people. You cannot get away from complicated people. You have to learn to work with them, live with them. Dare I say, love them. Because complicated people, they're at the carpool pickup line. These people are crazy. It's complicated. They're at youth sporting events. Trust me, it gets complicated real fast. Me and my son, we were at a national tournament this summer, and a mom got so upset. I have video of this, and I would show you the video, but she could go to Chase Oaks, and I don't want to embarrass you wherever you are. Nevertheless, a mom got so mad at a game, she ran across the court and began to try and attack our coach with a poodle in her hand. And our coach, just straight gangster, he goes, you ain't tough, you got a poodle in your hand. What gangster has a poodle? I went, this is insane. It's complicated. I don't know if you're a parent, but parenting, complicated. Our child, he's 5 years old, he ran away the other day. He just walked out the house. I caught him 4 houses down. I'm like, where are you going? He's like, I don't know, I was just going for a walk. I'm like, you can't just leave our house whenever you want. And I wanted to cuss him out, but I got Chase Oakers in the neighborhood, and it's complicated. It's like, I'm like, he's fine. Nothing going on here. Come on, Roman, get inside. Are you out of your mind? And so, like, and I heard the older they get, the more complicated they become. It's complicated. Dating, I've heard, is complicated. Somebody going through it over there. Complicated. I heard it's complicated online. I heard it's complicated offline. It's just different. It's complicated. Marriage, certified complicated. We've been married almost 12 years in June. It took me about 10 years to really lock in on our communication and to help my wife believe that I am indeed listening to her, because the first decade, being the Christ-like husband that I try to be every day, I try to serve my wife as best as I possibly can. And if I'm running errands, hey, babe, can I pick up a coffee for you, whatever? And inevitably, while I would pick up the coffee, I would get the order wrong because I'm a multitasker. I'm looking at sports. I'm on the phone. I'm doing all kinds of stuff. I'm writing books like mid-order. And so I would always bring this wrong order home. And so it became a tension in our marriage. And so I just figured out I needed a system. I needed a foolproof system to get her order right. I said, hey, babe, don't tell me your order. Text it to me. Then I can read the order out loud. And then if it's wrong, it's the barista's fault. It's not me. Okay, so now we figured out a plan. And so I'll never forget, she texts me her order. I'm feeling great about this day. I'm like, I'm about to get a W with my wife. Okay, I get in the Starbucks drive-thru and I read her order out loud. Smile on my face. And then the barista says something that struck fear into my soul. She says, sir, would you like that drink hot or cold? I said, it can be hot or cold. What? It's not in the text. It's not here. You don't understand. I am in a life or death situation. Have you seen like a little Puerto Rican woman come in here and order a drink all the time? Do you know if it's hot or if it's cold? Because I don't know. And people are honking at me behind me. I call her. She wanted to jump in the shower. Perfect timing. And so I panicked. And so they said, sir, hot or cold? I said, let me get both. I'm a veteran now, okay? I ain't got time for it. Let me get both. Now, Dave Ramsey might look at our coffee budget and go, this is a little high. I would say, hey, Dave, it's complicated, okay? Divorce, complicated. Half of every single person watching today's message, half of every single person in this room has had a front row seat to complicate it. In fact, unfortunately, my wife's father cheated on her mother when she was a child, and they got divorced. And the way my wife's brother tells this story is so powerful. He says, my dad did not cheat on my mother. My dad cheated on us. It's complicated. You see, what I'm learning about the world around me is that every single person shows up to their job, they show up to their home, they show up to their church, they show up to a gymnasium, they show up to their classroom with a lot of complicated. And sometimes we are judging other people for outside behavior, having no idea what's going on the inside. And so my hope and my prayer today is that we would learn through biblical strategies to be the kinds of people that move slow enough to move towards people we would rather ignore. Why? Because I think that's what we would want someone to do for us if they really knew what was going on with us. So the first thing that I think is vitally important if we are going to work with complicated people is, number one, we have to realize our own complications. We have to realize our own complications. I know there might be a temptation that today's message, you go, man, there might be somebody in your mind. Every time I tell somebody I'm working on a book called How to Work with Complicated People, I see a person run through their brain and they go, I need that book. But I've yet to hear the person say, somebody needs this book for me. I love what Romans 3 verse 23 says. It says, for everyone has sinned, we all fall short of God's glorious standard. Let's all say that together. Say, we all fall short. Don't you wish it said they all? Ooh, wouldn't that be fun? Like, wouldn't it be great if it was like, hey, I found a verse about you today. It says you fall short of glory. Like I wish you would get it together. Like, we can have this idea that everyone else is getting the better end of the deal. Whoever's dating us, whoever's following us, like whoever is married to us, whoever is being parented by us, like they're the ones getting a good deal. They've got the better end of the stick. It's just that would be a false story. Like, wouldn't it be awesome if we could go to, like, I don't know, perfectpeople.com and find those people to work with and date and parent? We could adopt children straight off of that website. The only problem is we wouldn't be on the website. Nobody would. And so what would it look like for us to be the kinds of people that look in the mirror before pointing a finger? Let me go first. Hi, my name is Ryan Lee, and I'm complicated. I have what my friends and family call selector frugality. What that means is I will spare no expense for some things, and I am insanely cheap on other things. I'm the kind of guy that will stay at a five-star resort, but will go to Walmart and get bottles of water for the room because I ain't paying $9 a bottle in this room. I ain't got time for it today. Now, my wife is embarrassed as I'm walking through with Walmart bags through a five-star resort. She's like, why did we come? How do you think we got here, okay? Like, we say, like, there's a reason we can be here, okay? Like, but again, it's selective frugality. I'm complicated. I have what's called JOMO. The joy of missing out. I don't have FOMO, okay? I have JOMO. I am so happy for you. I'm going to bed at 9 o'clock. You wanna go out at 10? Enjoy yourself. I am so happy for you. I am introverted with an extroverted career. What does that mean? It means I love having people over to my house for 1 hour. After that, you got to go. You got to go. It was great to have you. It's time for you to go, okay? I ain't got time for the lingering. We ate. We had a great conversation. That's great. Your time is up. I'll just start cleaning while people at the house. Hey, y'all good? Let me get up under your feet. I'm just sending signals. It's time to wrap this thing up. We got places to be. Actually, you got places to be. I'm trying to go to sleep, okay? Like, some people think I'm rude. I'm like, I'm not rude. I'm complicated. I went first. Your turn. Could it be that on the other side of us, there is some complexity? Because what I know about you and what I know about me is every single one of us has a pace, a preference, a personality that may not vibe well with someone else. I know there might be somebody in your mind that you think has the gift of getting on your last nerves, but is it possible that we're doing the same thing to somebody else? In our study of Working America, we discovered that when we asked them the question about how many complicated people do they work with, the average working American said 3 to 5. So the average working American is going, there's about 3 to 5 people at my job that are a little complicated. Okay, that's great. Then we asked the question, how complicated do you think you are? 74% of working Americans think they are less complicated than average. In other words, this is what most of us are doing. We're walking into our job and going, I can't believe I got to deal with all these complicated people. Thank God I'm not one of them. It's like, what? Here, if you want to get better at working with complicated people and living with complicated people and being married to a complicated person, get in the boat with them. And go, you know what? Maybe I'm not the easiest to deal with. Maybe I think I'm inspiring when I could be intimidating. Maybe I think I'm empowering, but I'm actually a micromanager. Maybe I think I'm super clear, but I might be a little bit vague. Just because you said it doesn't mean they heard it. I actually just want to be considerate of my own complications. I just love what Colossians 3 verse 12 says. It says, since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourselves with tenderhearted mercy and kindness and humility and gentleness and patience. And then verse 13 says, make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. The New International Version says, bear with one another. What does that mean? It means, really? You again? Okay, yeah, do that. That's what we want you. We want you to bear with one another. Why? Because that's what God has done with us. Instead, he doesn't go, you again. He goes, I paid for this. And here you are again and again and again. When I was growing up, I used to hear that we serve a God of second chances. I think it's way more than second. Don't you? It's more like the God of the 2 millionth chance. You know what I mean? It's like, it's infinite. It never runs out. His mercies are new every single morning for you and for me. So what would it look like for us to copy and paste that into our relationships with the people we deem most complicated? It says make allowance. Think about that word, allowance. Perhaps you used to get those. Remember when that was nice? Somebody would just give that to you for taking out the trash. Now you just take out the trash and you get nothing. And so But an allowance, it's a specific amount. I'm gonna give you a specific amount, and once you run out, you run out. But you're gonna get it every week. I'm gonna give you an allowance. Imagine if we did that emotionally and relationally with the people in our life, where we said, hey, this week, I'm gonna give you an allowance. An allowance, and an allowance specifically for your faults. Make allowance for other people's faults. In other words, you're gonna walk into your job, you're gonna walk into your homes, you're gonna walk into Thanksgiving, you're gonna walk in with your in-laws, you're gonna walk into the gym, you're gonna walk into the classroom, and you're gonna go, hey, I realize that you have some faults, and I ought to leave some allowance in my back pocket for them. You're gonna say something, infer something, you're gonna have some body language, you're going to do something that might offend me, you might steal a sale from me, you might make a smart remark at me, or you may not compliment me the way that I think you should, you might not tell me that I'm beautiful, like you might make me feel some type of way, but guess what, I'm actually going to make an allowance for you. What does that mean? It means I'm going to give you a break before you need one. I've already decided. I'm gonna give you a break. Because here's what happens. Anytime we're having a conversation with somebody and it's tense and you find out they're behind the scenes, you go, oh, my bad. I didn't know. I had a long day. Assume that they're going to have one. I had a friend tell me once, he said, I was asking him about another coworker. I said, hey, how's everything going with Greg? He said, they're dead to me. I said, dead? They died? How'd they die? What happened? Dead to me? Oh my goodness, this is such a strong language. What did this man do to merit this emotional funeral you just gave him? But here's what's interesting. It gives us interesting math when we cancel other people. They hurt me, let me just get rid of you and just stay away from you. You're dead to me. But if I hurt someone else, our natural inclination is, well, give me a break. Come on, man, you didn't know what I was going through during that time. I had COVID. I was sick, I lost somebody, I lost a job, I lost a friend, I lost a house. I was going through a divorce. I found out that who I thought was my best friend, it actually wasn't. I found out that they cheated on me. Did you know what was going on in my life? And when we find out somebody's behind the scenes, we go, oh, my bad. And we let them off the hook. Here's what I'm encouraging you to do. Assume that they have a complicated behind the scenes and just give them the break early. Don't wait. And the reason I know that they have a complicated behind the scenes is because you do. And so give them the break that you wish someone was giving to you. Give them the allowance for their faults. Let me ask you this. Do people in your life have an allowance with you? Does your spouse have an allowance with you? Or are they always on strike too? Are your kids, do they have an allowance with you? Does your leader, does your colleague, does your neighbor, does your coach, does your teacher, do those parents that have all these crazy requests for you, do they have an allowance with you? It's like, why would we give them that? We shouldn't. They don't deserve it. But that's kind of the point. That's the point of God's grace. You didn't deserve it. Christians are a group of people that simply give away what they didn't deserve to people that don't deserve it. That is the point of God's amazing grace. So if we want to get better at dealing with complicated people, we have to actually accept the fact that we are one of those people. In other words, I'm not teaching you how to deal with complicated people. I'm teaching you how to deal with you. And if you learn how to deal with you, you'd be surprised how you treat other people. The second thing I think is vitally important for us to deal and work with complicated people is never let their behavior dictate ours. We cannot let somebody else's behavior dictate ours. And sometimes when dealing and working with complicated people, you and I find ourselves in a position where we are letting their behavior dictate ours. But what I want to give you the power to do today is to take control of your life and take control of your relationships. It doesn't mean you're controlling. It means you're intentional. It means you're the one that's going to say, I'm going to set the temperature of this relationship. And there might be some things that we disagree on, but I can disagree with you without disrespecting you. And so, yes, I can control that by the tone in which I speak to another human being, because I'm in control. I'm not going to let your behavior dictate mine. I love what we see in Acts chapter 8, verse 1. It says, and Saul approved of his execution. Who's his? It's a guy named Stephen. He's one of the first people to be killed for his faith in Jesus Christ. And Saul just so happens to be the same guy that wrote 2/3 of the New Testament, is sitting there approving it. He's approved of this execution. He has struck fear inside of Christians in this region. And it says this, it says, and there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem. And so what'd they do? Well, they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria. They all took off running. But then the scripture gives us three words, three very, very powerful words. It says, except the apostles. Everybody's on the run except the apostles. There's a lot of reasons to have fear, but except the apostles. The apostles are going, y'all should run, but we are an exception. Why? Well, because this guy asked us to follow him and nobody picked us, but he did for some odd reason. He shouldn't have. We didn't even know what he's talking about half the time. We were just as confused as everybody else. But nevertheless, we followed this guy around. And guess what? He kept telling us that he was going to die and be buried and come back to life. And then he pulled it off and took us to breakfast. We've never seen anything like this in our life. And so guess what? We ain't going nowhere because we know real power. We'll be all right. Everyone's running that way. But the apostle said, we're not going to let them. And we're not going to let a government. We're not going to let Saul at the time. We're not going to let where the herd is going dictate who God has called us to be. Another example that we see in the Old Testament, 1 Samuel 30, verse 9. You may, if you are a Christ follower and you follow the life of David, you may have heard of a moment in David's life where the scripture says, and David encouraged himself in the Lord. And David encouraged himself in the Lord. The reason he had to do that was because the Amalekites actually took captive his family and all of their stuff and a whole village. And so David was sad. And then the scripture says, and then David encouraged himself in the Lord. And once he encouraged himself in the Lord, he said, boy, strap up, let's go. We're going to go get our families back and we're going to get our stuff back. And then 1 Samuel 30 verse 9 says, David and 600 men with him came to the Besor Valley where some stayed behind. 200 of them were too exhausted to cross the valley, but David and the other 400 continued their pursuit. 200 of the men went, I'm tired of fighting. I'm tired of being on the run. We're just too exhausted. David and the remaining 400 said, let's keep going. In verse 17, it says, David fought them from dusk until the evening of the next day, and none of them got away except 400 young men who rode off on camels and fled. David recovered everything the Amalekites had taken, including his two wives. They've been fighting all night long. We got our stuff back. And then, verse 21 says, then David came to the 200 men who had been too exhausted to follow him and who were left behind at the Besor Valley. They came out to meet David and the men with him. And David, as David and his men approached, he asked them how they were. They sitting by the brook chilling. We just fought all night. David walks up and says, how are you doing? And this indignated the people with him. It says, but all the evil men and troublemakers among David's followers said, because they did not go out with us, we will not share with them the plunder we recovered. However, each man may take his wife and children and go, but they're not getting our stuff. And then David replied, no, my brothers, you must not do that with what the Lord has given us. What do you think you own? You think we won the battle because you're awesome? You did it. He goes on to say, it was God who protected us. Oh yeah, it was God who delivered into our hands the raiding party that came against us. Who will listen to what you say? The share of the man who stayed with the supplies is to be the same of that of him who went down to battle. All will share alike. David made this a statute and ordinance for Israel from that day to this. It's like, David, that's not fair. You got all of these men who worked really hard for something and like you're giving it to some people that were too weak. We were strong when they were weak. We deserve more. This is not fair, David. But what about the gospel is fair? A perfect man was crucified for us. There's nothing about this that is fair. And because it's so unfair for Jesus, Christians are not this elitist group of people that think they're just better than everybody else. Christians are a group of people that think we're just going to treat people like somebody died for us. It's not fair, I know. But what about the gospel is fair? I want to encourage you to be one of those people this weekend that doesn't let where they work determine how they work. Don't let where you live determine how you live. Some of us we feel like we're products of environments. You don't have to be that way. I just want you to know today that you got choices. You got an opportunity to be a different kind of person that doesn't let other people's behavior dictate your behavior. I recently had a friend, he came to me, he said, "Hey Ryan, can I talk to you for a second?" I said, "I'm an introvert, so you got about 5 minutes, so hurry it up. What you need? What's going on?" He said, "Hey man, I just really want to talk to you." I said, "Man, talk to me, man. Tell me, what's happening?" He said, "Man, and we're having this conversation in Frisco." And he says, "Man, I don't know how to tell you this, but I got this friend. I don't know what to do with him." I said, "Well, what did he do?" He said, "Man, I just found out that this friend, he's a Republican." I said, "In Texas? How did that happen?" He's like, "So what do I do?" I'm like, "Well, what are our options?" He goes, "I mean, I guess I could cut him off." I went, "You're gonna need a lot of scissors, bro. You're gonna need like you're gonna have to get rid of like so many people in your life. Like it's crazy." Same thing happened. I was talking to a friend in California. He goes, "Dude, I found out a Democrat goes to my church." I'm like, "You did? And what did you do when you saw this person? Did they try to punch you? Did they like what happened?" It's like, what should we do with these people? I don't know. What did you do in 2023 before you knew? You just like, I don't know, loved them? Crazy concept. You asked them how they were doing. And why am I bringing this up in what can be an awkward election season is, yes, I think we all should vote, and I think our vote has a lot of power, but it should not have enough power to change somebody else's behavior. You should not let somebody else's vote turn you into a person you wouldn't even want to be friends with. It shouldn't have that much power. So what would it look like for you to be the kind of person that says, "Man, I know I live in America, and I love what place God has me, but I can't let where I live determine how I live. And I might work in a job environment that's got a lot going on. It might be a toxic environment, but that does not mean you have to be a toxic person. You do not have to let somebody else's behavior dictate yours." Now, I was out to eat with my siblings in Chicago, and we were at a nice restaurant, and we began to have a conversation about tip culture, because tip culture is getting out of hand. You know what I'm saying? You could be at Starbucks, and they're like, "Hey, could you answer this question?" You know what the question is. Don't act all surprised. It's a tip question. You can pick up a water at a gas station. They're like, "Tip?" I'm like, "You did nothing, but what am I supposed to do here?" And so we were having this tip conversation, and like everyone was going around the table and kind of sharing their philosophy on how they think tipping should be. And I'm not gonna throw my sister under the bus and put her name out there because she might be watching this right now. Hey, Lana. Nevertheless, and my sister began sharing her tip philosophy. And she gave her number, and I don't wanna put her number out there. You know, it was like 10, 15%. I was like, "Oh my goodness." And she began to share a number, and she goes, "Well, Ryan, what's your number? Like, how do you like to tip people?" I go, "Well, you know, my wife and I, we try to do, you know, 30 to 40%. She goes, "What?" I said, "Lana," I said her name again, my bad. Listen, I said to this random person, I said to my sister, I said, "Hey sis, here's the deal. Like, in light of the family we wanna be and the impact we wanna make in the world, we've just decided that generosity is going to be one of our top values in our home. This is how we want our kids to behave. We, in our house, we're givers." And then she asked a question. She said, "Well, what if it's bad service?" I said, "Then the tip's even better. Because our tip is not an indication of their character. Our tip is an indication of ours and the kind of people that we want to be. I refuse to let a stranger dictate the kind of person that I know God has called me to be." I don't know if you got some baby mama drama headed to your house over the holidays, and you might be in a very dramatic family. I just want to let you know, you don't have to be in the movie. You can decide right now, "Hey, I'm gonna actually make allowance for this family. I'm gonna make an allowance for the people in my life. The third thing I think is vitally important for us to work with complicated people is number three, look for God's perspective on them. There's a story in the book of Acts between a guy named Peter and Cornelius. They're on opposite ends of any kind of spectrum you can think of. And Acts 10 verse 1 says, at Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion of what was known as the Italian cohort, a Roman military officer, a devout man who feared God with all his household, gave alms generously to people and prayed continually to God. This is a good man. He's trying to make a difference in his community. But he's not Jewish. And for Peter, that's a deal breaker. About the ninth hour of the day, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God come in and say to him, Cornelius! And he stared at him in terror. And you would too if a giant angel rolled up into your master bedroom. And he said, what is it, Lord? And he said to him, your prayers and your alms have ascended as a memorial before God, and now send men to Joppa and bring one Simon who was called Peter. Right away, what this angel is asking Cornelius to do is like, I don't think he's come, eh? But scripture says, verse 9, the next day as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the housetop about the sixth hour to pray, and he became hungry. You ever been trying to pray and you got hungry? So he's like, man, let me get a snack real quick. That's what happened. So he wanted something to eat, but while they were preparing, he fell into a trance and saw the heavens open and something like a great sheet descending, being let down by its four corners upon the earth. In it were all kinds of animals and reptiles and birds of the air. And there came a voice to him, rise, Peter, kill and eat. But Peter said, by no means, Lord, for I've never eaten anything that is common or unclean. I want you to notice the two men's different responses. Cornelius said, what is it, Lord? Peter said, by no means, Lord. You ever told God no? You know what I mean? It's like, God, you got the wrong guy. I like your stuff, but that's not for me. And then Acts 10:15 says, and the voice came to him a second time. God's like, hey, Peter, it's me again. I'm trying to get your attention. What God has made clean, do not call common. This happened three times. Sometimes we're those kinds of people that make God put in extra work to get our attention. And while Peter was pondering the vision, verse 19, the Spirit said to him, behold, three men are looking for you. Rise and go down and accompany them without hesitation, for I have sent them. He goes to Cornelius' house. And Peter, as he talked with him, verse 27, he went in and found many persons gathered. And he said to them, you yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or to visit anyone of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. If you remember in verse 14, it says, by no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean. But just 14 verses later, he says, but God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. Anything became any person in prayer. You have a complicated person in your life somewhere in your world, maybe online, maybe offline. I'm just gonna ask you to pray about seeing them a little bit different. I'm gonna encourage you to try and look for God's perspective on the person that is making your life a little bit more complicated. If you're married today, one of the most powerful things you can do is to say, Lord, how do you see this person that you've given me? If you've been blessed with children, one of the best things that we can do is to say, Lord, could you give me your perspective on these children, adult children? Maybe even a child that isn't on speaking terms with you right now. You may not be on speaking terms with your parents. I just can only imagine what it would look like for you to say, dear God, how do you see my parents? How do you see my mom? How do you see my dad? How do you see the people in my life that perhaps I've deemed complicated? And in that moment, I can only imagine what God will do in your heart. Let me say it this way. I can only imagine what God will do with your eyes. You just see them different. Because what I know about every single person under the sound of my voice today is we all got to complicate it behind the scenes. And I have to imagine what it would look like for us to look upon the people in our life with a little bit more grace in our hearts and in our eyes. So in summary, number one, if we're going to work with complicated people, we gotta get in the boat with them. We have to realize our own complications. Hi, my name is Ryan Lee, and I'm complicated. Don't forget, it's your turn. Number two, never let their behavior dictate ours. You've got some people in your life that can get up under your skin. You could get up under their skin, but you don't ever want to do the eye for the eye thing. You're better than that. So be better than that. Be the kind of person that says, I'm going to set the tone at family dinner. I'm going to set the tone at our job. I know there's some things going on here that I don't think are right, but I can learn to disagree without disrespect, and I can be one of those catalyst people that say, you know what, I'm going to actually treat people like somebody died for me, because they did. His name is Jesus. And lastly, we're going to look for God's perspective on the people that can drive us the most crazy. And we can only pray that they're doing the same thing for us. That's how I think we can work with complicated people. God, I thank you so much for this amazing church. I pray, Lord, that you would indeed help us see people through your eyes. I pray, God, that you would help us move towards people that we would typically steer away from. Help us to do the tough thing. Help us to do the Jesus thing. In Jesus' precious name, I pray, everybody said, amen. You go ahead and stand to your feet.